I was reminded by Mother Teresa, who's recently passed, and when the intrusion occurred, I went straight to Mother Teresa, and Carol Harris was right, like one of the first people to say, I'll be there, I'll be there right, about noon, I'll be right there. And so I really felt comforted by that, because it wasn't just for me, it's for everyone who's here today. So Mother Teresa's anyway poem, if we think about compassion and forgiveness, if we think about the people who are involved, and if we think about ourselves, if we go to compassion and forgiveness for ourselves, maybe we didn't know to have a steel door, maybe we didn't have the budget at the time, or maybe it was 76 years old, I don't know. But if we have compassion for ourselves, so she says to love anyway. She says to forgive anyway, to succeed anyway. So she says, people are often unreasonable, illogical, and self-centered. Yeah, and I can imagine people need to survive and make their needs or whatever that is, that's where the focus is. She asks us to forgive anyways. Forgive them anyway. If you are kind, people may accuse you of selfish, ulterior motives. Be kind, anyways. If you are successful, you will win some false friends and some true enemies. Succeed, anyway. If you are honest and frank, people may cheat you. Be honest and frank, anyways. What you spend years building, some could try and destroy, they could destroy overnight. Build, anyway. If you find serenity and happiness, they may be jealous. Be happy, anyway. And Cindy was here, and so it was a deep relief because we were all around the building. She was inside with Tricia Cowan, our administrative assistant, seeing that things were happening. And much like Lucinda Cronin, who's been here during the week, we needed more furniture, much like Sandy had come to her just naturally. That was a gift of Reverend Debbie Marks. And so, yeah, we needed another volunteer workstation, so we were open to that so that we can succeed. So be happy anyways. The good you do today, people will often forget tomorrow. Do good anyway. Give the world the best that you have, and it may never be enough. Remember the four agreements? Do your best. Always do your best. Nothing more or nothing less. Always do your best. The good you do today will often be forgotten tomorrow. Do good anyway. Give the world the best you have, and it may never be enough. Give the world the best you've got anyway. You see, in the final analysis, it is between you and your God. It is never between you and them anyway. So we bring it home to our own heart to have more compassion, to have more forgiveness. And it is a great and grand and glorious morning that we have brought here with us today and that we're going to continue to have. It's a great, grand, and glorious morning. And isn't it great to just breathe the fresh air? When I woke up this morning, I think, ooh, it's cool, and I'm breathing the fresh air. And I can look up into the sky and I can see that there's possibility. I can also know that I'm standing on solid ground and maybe it's higher ground. So we get to hang our hat on something that's higher ground. And we look into the sky and we say thank you for everything that there is. We thank you for this wake-up call that we've had as we go with it with gratitude instead of resentment, instead of anger. We move through that gently and quickly. We move through what those natural responses are, the resentment, the fear. How are we going to get this thing shut by dark? And are we going to have the resourcefulness? Are we going to have the creativity? It's a special order. All these sorts of things. And it was well done. It was done. It was swift. It was amazing. It was just absolutely amazing. So I'm grateful. And I walk forward with us in compassion, in a sense of abundance, knowing that, yes, we are creative. Yes, we are resourceful. And that we're able to breathe the fresh air of the sky. And our leadership was at a mini retreat yesterday, and it was beautiful to be up at Dan Castle's home in Forest Falls. And we looked at what our shared values were that we've all created as a community, but in many ways. We also did some meditation, some affirmations, and prayer. Meditation, affirmations, and prayer. It gave us a map. Meditation, affirmations, and prayer. So yes, we have a map. Would you please stand if you participated in the leadership retreat? I'd like to acknowledge you. So thank you for saying yes, so we can say yes to that which our heart calls us for and what our heart's desire is. So we experience those shared values that we all created as a community. We experience love and peace and generosity and acceptance and compassion and joy. And you'll notice those are on the bulletin, and we begin to see those everywhere. So that's the lens that we look through. And we also are looking through the lens of sufficiency, knowing that, yes, there is enough. And so with the intrusion that we had, there was not sufficiency in that person's life. They were looking at something external rather than something that was internal or something that they could be resourceful about. And so as we look internally, as we know that, yes, we are compassionate, and we are forgiving, yes, we have generosity happening for us, much like Mother Teresa, who is urging us to forgive anyway, be kind, be honest, be frank, build, and be happy about building and do good. Anyway, it is the season of atonement, which that also means forgiveness. So it also means at-one-ment. If we look at the word atonement, it's at-one-ment. And so we're knowing our oneness. We're knowing that spirit is revealed in our expressions as we forgive and we succeed anyways. And so I'm joining, do you remember those resolutions that we had at the beginning of the year? Well, it's for my Jewish friends, it's the new year. It's a time to have a sense of atonement and atonement. So I'm wishing all my Jewish friends a happy new year. And I'm knowing that there is peace in the beginning, in new beginnings, and that we can have that nurturing kindness. We can also see love everywhere. We can also revisit what our highest resolution is. So imagine if you were to start again. You can also look to 2017, what that new year has in store, and to have that higher resolve, to go to that higher ground. And we can be even more consistent with our living our love, living our peace, living our generosity, living our sense of acceptance and compassion and joy. And so I have a little bit of humor that goes with this. Oftentimes, a New Year's resolution is something that goes in one year and out the other. In one year and out the other. For perhaps not after today. So maybe it's a New Year's commitment. So as our friends are experiencing Rosh Hashanah, then there's a new year commitment. There's a new commitment. We can also say, okay, dear God, my affirmative prayer is a fat bank account and a thin body. Please don't mix it up like you did perhaps this year. Don't mix up a fat bank account and a thin body. And I have only one resolution, and it's to discover the difference between wants and needs, and may I have all I need and want all that I have. So we have a beautiful place here that's filled with loving, kind people. And so in light of this Jewish New Year, Rosh Hashanah, we can revisit that higher resolve that we have for our lives. So we bring in all world's traditions, and we take what Dr. Ernest Holmes, who is the founder of the Science of Mind, which is a guide for spiritual living, we take what he had to offer because he synthesized the world's religions. And so with this holiday of the New Year and the atonement, if we look at the declarations, which he spouted off to a reporter and asked, oh, what do you believe? One of his declaration principles, he says, we believe in the direct revelation of truth through the intuitive and spiritual nature of the individual. So we have this nature, this listening to a higher place. And in this teaching, we can know that we're a part of something larger, that there is this one mind, one spirit, and we all share this essence. And this intuition is spirit knowing of itself. Because we are one in this, what we know and feel on a collective level is evidence that, yes, there is this divine nature that is within us. So as we were up at Forest Falls yesterday, we were looking at the beautiful trees and being in nature and knowing that divine essence was also in us. It was around us and also within us, and that we are expressions of it. And so we have three things today that we'll take with us and how we can experience. We can know that there are things that we learn in books, that we have spiritual studies. We learn, you know, we're always, I am anyways, anyone ever learning and growing, I'm always learning and growing. There are things that we can learn in spiritual study. There are also some things that people tell us, like Mother Teresa, like Dr. Ernest Holmes. Then three, there's something that we just know without evidence of any tangible source. There's something that we just have a knowingness about. We feel a presence, we feel an essence, we feel this love, we feel this peace. So there's an example of what we might pick up in books, whether it's on Kindle or whether it's, this is our book of the month, Vital Signs. It's about discovering and sustaining our passion for life by Gray LeBoy. Many people, we realize that we're an instrument when we take an instrument of spirit, that we can fine-tune that instrument when we take a class at the center. And so we can be more first class. We can have a class and be more first class in our life. And one of our students had a kind of a cosmic experience, and they had an experience of a deeper dimension of what was real to them. They listened to their intuition. And in the amazement of people, it amazed people how poignant it was and what a difference it made in their life. It also inspired other people in the class. And so there was a sense that there was a presence and a power that was within them. And to just speak about that and to have that sense of oneness. And so that person brought that experience to class. And the people in class began to look at that there was that experience all around them, wholeness. And so when Carol was first out of the box, I saw wholeness. And that was the lens I was looking through on that day. It's, yes, I'm seeing wholeness in this and how this can be remedied and how we can have things come together swiftly and resourcefully. So Dr. Ernest Holmes says that which is apparently outside can become known to the individual through intuition. Because the perception and the perceiver, that's us, must be in one and the same mind. And so there's some neurology to support this too. There's some quantum physics that supports this field of love and this unified field. He says, no object can appear to exist in the objective world unless there's first a subjective world to perceive the object. We're the observers. We're noticing what's going on. We're elevating our awareness of what's going on. There's no object outside of reality, but reality must be an infinite perceiver, an infinite mind, and one mind common to all people. So we are the perceivers. We get to shift the context of our perception when we're open to a chicken coop, when we're open to a new workstation for a volunteer, when we're open to that which gives us a feeling of safety and security and people coming together in community to love one another. So it's a reason that we can understand each other because we have this field of love and peace and generosity and all those qualities. Whether or not we're speaking the same language, even whether or not we have that gift of sight, you know, some people have different gifts. We have different gifts of levels of intuition, and some people have different gifts of hearing. Because there's something that we feel. We feel love. We feel love in that process. So we can learn stuff in books. We can also learn things that people tell us. So I'm like NPR, I'm always listening, or PBS. I'm always listening for what people tell us and that I can share that works for my life. We can see videos of people all over the world enjoying the same song all over the world. Have you seen some of those? Like Playing for Change, and they're playing the same song all over the world. We can listen to things that people tell us, or that people, when they show up as love or joy or freedom or as harmony, even when there's a great tragedy in the world, whether it's local, whether it's something that's far away, we can feel connected somehow. We can come back to ourself. Even when there's a great tragedy, if it shakes our world, if it shakes us at whatever level, it affects us on the individual level. It's as if we're moving through this a shared evolution. We're moving through a shared transformation. So yeah, lots of transformation on the physical side of things. It also, for me, it gives me more courage. It also, there was a gentleman even in our parking lot who wanted to, thank you Elijah for helping me greet this gentleman who wanted to do a service this morning, and to just notice that he had a place to serve. So we have heroes showing up at all hours here. So something happens when the world seems to be shaking, we can realize that we're on solid ground, then that we can reach for higher ground. We're moving through what is evolving through us, and that wants to be transformed. So there's certain moments that we share together, because there's really one of us here. So that as we stay with the one, as we stay with that sense of oneness, of wholeness, of balance, of harmony, we can plumb the depths of that mind. We can plumb the depths of oneness and wholeness in our life. And Ernest Holmes says, too, it's impossible to plumb the depths of the individual mind. Plumbing, like fishing, if you were to go cast out, cast the line, go fishing, plumb the depths. It is impossible to plumb the depths of the individual mind, because the individual mind is really not individual, but it's individualized. We're all unique expressions of this one presence, of this one essence. Behind the individual is the universal, which has no limits. In this concept alone lies the possibility of eternal and endless expansion. Everyone is universal on the subjective side of life. The individual only at the point of conscious perception. Remember, I just talked about perception. The riddle is solved, and we all use the creative power of the universal mind every time we use our own mind. It's like tuning into the radio. Those waves are already broadcasting, and we fine-tune some jazz, or classical channel, or NPR, whatever that is. The creator, that divine spirit, that energy, whatever we want to call that essence, is within each and every one of us, playing its own tune. We are that instrument. We are that chalice. We are that vessel. And it is the dimension of ourselves that connects us to the source energy. It's that spirit within. It is that those moments in our lives when we're really clear about something. Those moments of clarity, that listening to that divine guidance and inspiration. So then that's number three, is we're listening to what we may not have physical evidence for yet, but we're planting those, we're having those images. It's even beyond our imagination sometimes. Our creativity. I was teaching this class online, and I had my cell phone in something like that. What is it, Alexa, that has, it's that tower that Amazon has, that Alexa, you can converse with it and say, play me a tune, or find me this item, or whatever that is. But I have what's like Cortana that's on the laptop. I didn't know it was turned on, but I was teaching this class online. And it's something that you can ask her to go find something, like on my laptop. Okay, Cortana, go find this. Go. It's like having a wonderful dog that's well trained. Go fetch. And I was mystified. I really was mystified, literally and figuratively, when I said the spiritual principle. I had this class online on Skype, and we were having a good time. And I said the spiritual principle, and then Cortana was over here about 1 foot away, and she says, "Of course." She was cheered. She knew that that was some universal principle. Of course. It's like, of course. So one of my students was looking for a job. She thought she was looking for a job. And through her willingness in this class, she became more of herself. And she realized that she had that inner guidance that she could follow. And I'm telling you what I know here, this universal principle, it's ever available. It's ever available to tap into. And so it's everywhere. It's being itself. It's being these folks in the front row. It's being them singing up here. It's everywhere. So it's what I know. And so it's being itself totally and completely. And so one of my students had wanted to work in Hollywood. And she's very creative. She wanted to do set design because she had an artistic eye and she could see herself in this vision. And so she had these wonderful gifts. And so she sent her resumes out. She'd done her work. She'd done her prayer work, and she put it into action. And she really had this proclivity for beauty. She just, I mean, it was lovely what she created. And she'd done some types of murals and all these kinds of creative things. And she came to some classes, and she was exploring the spiritual principle I talked about earlier, our meditation, our affirmations, and our prayers. So she was following her map. And so she was driving to, if she had another job, she didn't have the job that she wanted, but she had another job that was getting her to where her soul's desire could be fulfilled. So she really felt good about it after doing the meditation, after having some affirmations, so she could really feel and embody and accept herself being in this role. She really felt good about it. And so one day on her way to work, she was driving, and there was this antique store that caught her eye that was coming up off the off-ramp. And something compelled her. She thought, I don't have the time, I don't have the money, I don't need an antique. What is the deal with this? She did not have any inclination to go shopping. She didn't like shopping. And so she was on her way to work, this job that was funding her vision, and she was about to drive past the off-ramp, and she just had to go. Had to go to this antique store. This inner feeling rose up, and she got off the freeway. Can you imagine? Has that happened to you? And she started going through the aisles when she opened the doors of the antique store. She picked up the most beautiful things, and she was just orchestrating this wonderful experience. And this lady says, man, you have a really good eye. I love what you picked out. What do you do? And so she started to tell her what her dream was, what her vision was. And the lady says, here's my card. Give me a call. And you know who it was? It was this gal who she had placed several calls, and she was very important, and she was very busy and hard to get hold of and had not returned her call. This lady was the lady she was trying to have a meeting with for months. This is this antique store. And you know what? She got hired. She didn't know how to do it, but she put it out there as, here's what I want to do. Because she was giving herself permission, she had the willingness to experience her fulfillment. So that is what she got to do. And so she allowed herself to be great. She allowed herself to be magnificent. She allowed life to flow through her beyond her wildest imagination. So I think we can join her in the sense of willingness and giving ourselves permission to be great. You ready to say an affirmation? Yes? I give myself permission to be great. I give myself permission to be great. I give myself permission to live an excellent life. I give myself permission to live an excellent life. I give myself permission to be whole, loving, and caring. I give myself permission to be whole, loving, and caring. I give myself permission to be prosperous. I give myself permission to be prosperous. I am freedom. I am freedom. So she discovered a context. Her context shifted. It was not merely a person looking for a job, but she was at the center of this universal essence. She knew that her gifts deserved. She just needed to express these gifts. It shifted the context from looking for a job, you know how we can have things come and go in our lives, but she was at the center of the universe, and she was living from a point of purpose. This is my purpose, this is my fulfillment, rather than whatever point of view that off the scales and call me back. She was staying really stuck in things not happening. So there's a shift. And it's the soul that unfolds, it's the soul evolving. It is the real progress, the real progress that takes place. So our inner work, that's what happens. Our context shifts when we do our inner work, when we have that map of meditation and affirmations and prayer. She wasn't just trying to get a job. She was coming from the energy of the entire universe. Imagine having the entire universe backing us up. It's like, I got your back. Okay, I have the entire universe backing me up, and I gave myself permission to be great. And so she was coherent in her own heart. Imagine being coherent on the soul level. She was making great progress to fulfill her dreams. And the universe matched that. She couldn't have told you how, but she knew what. She knew what that she wanted. She was here to fulfill great purpose on that soul level. And so there was a shift in her interior awareness. Her interior, it happened inside, and then she became more insightful about her living and what her purpose was. And so it was much like our mini retreat yesterday, where we saw the trees and the forest, and we were inspired to bring that back here with our divine nature. And so that context also determines our perception. So we have new perceptions. So we might go down the same road 12 times, right? We might keep going down that same road 12 times. But we may not have seen it differently because our interiority, our inner awareness had not shifted. So as our interiority is cleansed, our context is transformed. So then we accept and allow the greater good. And we give ourselves permission to be great and to recognize that there is this presence everywhere. So we see an experience of this as a way of living. We know that sometimes we get a nudge, a tap on the shoulder that sends us to an antique store, right? So we'll listen to that. And so the bonus is that we're not refusing anything, we're not blocking anything, we're not limiting our experience, but we're opening up to whatever this longing is for the soulful unfoldment, for this evolution, the spiritual evolution and unfoldment. So our soul is longing for its own evolution. And it is the soul which is unfurled, it is unfolding, it is evolving. So our action is to tune in with the things that we may learn in books, the things that we may learn that people tell us, the things that we know are we're intuitive about, and we listen to that aside from the setting, divine guidance, and we just know that there is something great and grand and glorious that is here for us. So living those shared values of love, peace, generosity, acceptance, compassion, and joy. I know that that is our takeaway today, that we share those values and that there is that soul unfoldment. And it is unleashed, and we are unleashed to receive these beautiful blessings, beautiful, blissful, and bountiful blessings. So I invite us to turn within and knowing that we can absolutely have this map which guides us along the way and listening to those, the beautiful artistry that is this one life. So there is this life which is filled full with the divine nature. And yes, it's very natural, it is in the flow, it is infinite. And in this infinite potential, I know that there is this spiritual expression of creativity, of oneness, of wholeness, of wellness. And that it is that which is the presence and essence, which is absolutely thriving everywhere. So knowing the generous nature of the universe, there is this universal unfoldment, and I am connected to this beautiful unified field that even quantum physics says that we are connected with the potentiality and that which is made actual. And our lives comes from this vantage point, being backed by the whole universe. It is the source energy, knowing that there is this divine source, which is all. That it is the prosperizing, harmonizing good. It is a sense of being healthy and well, having well-being. Knowing that there is a sense of love and peace, and it is that tranquility and serenity, which is this guidance and listening in this context of peace, knowing that there is a warm embrace and that there is a forward momentum from this place of this warm embrace. It is spirit nudging us on the shoulder and listening to this inner knowingness, this inner awareness, and being more elevated in this listening. I know that there is wisdom, there is love, there is life, there is this field of infinite potential and possibility, which shows up as beautiful opportunities. So looking through this place, looking and leading and loving along the way, I'm so, so very grateful, with deep appreciation, feeling moved and transformed in this very moment that there is this context of universal support and being in the flow. So I'm grateful in this grand and great and glorious day. It is the best day ever. Right here and right now. And I release this word, knowing yes, there is a creative action that acts upon it, and that there is fulfillment in love, in light, and in peace. And so be it. And so it is. Amen.